knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just wrapped up some tutorials covering pulmonary activity, so let's move on to cardiovascular pharmacology, which refers to drugs that help keep the heart beating and blood pumping. There are many classes of drugs that influence cardiovascular function, which in turn treat a variety of cardiovascular pathologies. To start, we will discuss angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, usually abbreviated as ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors are usually identifiable by the suffix pril. For example, benazepril, zafenopril, perindopril, trandolopril, captopril, enalapril, lisinopril, and ramipril. These drugs are primarily used in the treatment of high blood pressure. Acutely high blood pressure doesn't usually cause serious health complications, but chronic uncontrolled high blood pressure is a major risk factor for strokes, ischemic heart disease, and heart failure. These adverse clinical outcomes underline the importance of pharmacological agents that can manage high blood pressure. Before we dive into the pharmacology of how ACE inhibitors decrease blood pressure, it's important to understand some aspects of the physiology at which ACE inhibitors mediate their effects. The renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system is a homeostatic negative feedback loop that regulates blood pressure by regulating the volume of fluid in your cardiovascular system. The RAAS mechanism can be thought of in steps, but keep in mind that practically all physiological processes are happening in dynamic equilibrium, and the influence of each step of the mechanism will depend on the homeostatic set point of the system as a whole. First, the liver tonically secretes angiotensinogen, a precursor to angiotensin 1, the inactive version of angiotensin. When juxtaglomerular cells in the kidney detect a reduction in blood pressure via stretch receptors in blood vessels, renin release is increased. Renin release is also triggered by increases in the sympathetic nervous system tone and decreased Na+ and Cl- juxtaglomerular apparatus. Renin is an enzyme that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. As we mentioned, this version of angiotensin is inactive and requires further metabolism. Following circulation in the blood, angiotensin 1 will be converted to angiotensin 2. This reaction is catalyzed by angiotensin-converting enzyme, or ACE, produced in the lungs. This is the level at which ACE inhibitors showcase their pharmacology. Angiotensin 2, or AT2, is the active chemical entity that influences blood pressure. AT2 activates the angiotensin 2 receptor type 1, usually referred to as AT1R. This may be confusing, but the 1 in AT1R refers to the subtype of angiotensin 2 receptor, not to the version of angiotensin, whether that be 1 or 2. AT1R is the most important of these receptors. Activation of the AT1R by AT2 has a lot of consequences, depending on the tissue type the receptor is expressed on. The most important tissue type that expresses AT1R is vascular smooth muscle cells. AT1R is primarily a G-alpha-Q coupled G-protein coupled receptor, similar to the M3 muscarinic receptor we discussed in the tutorial on bronchodilators. Activation of AT1R by AT2 on vascular smooth muscle cells through G-alpha-Q increases the release of calcium stores in smooth muscle cells and increases their contractility, which in turn decreases the lumen of the blood vessel, leading to an increase in blood pressure. As discussed in the bronchodilators tutorial, G-alpha-Q signaling on smooth muscle cells causes the increase of contractility of smooth muscle cells in a few other mechanisms through protein phosphorylation. This is worth revisiting, but for the sake of brevity, this is the most important one. AT2 also stimulates the section of two hormones that act to increase blood pressure. These are aldosterone and antidiuretic hormone, or ADH, also known as vasopressin. Aldosterone is a steroidal mineralocorticoid secreted by the cortex of the adrenal gland. Aldosterone increases blood pressure mainly through activating the mineral corticoid receptor located on the nucleus of cells in the collecting duct and distal tubules of the nephron. The activation of this nuclear receptor increases the protein expression of the basolateral Na+K+ exchanger. This active exchanger uses ATP to pump two potassium ions into the lumen of the collecting duct in exchange for three sodium ions. This results in an osmotic gradient that leads to the reabsorption of water into the blood, which increases blood pressure and increases excretion of potassium in the urine. It's important to be aware that Cl- will also be reabsorbed to maintain electrochemical balance. As mentioned, AT2 also increases the release of ADH from the pituitary gland. This peptide hormone activates vasopressin receptors. Activation of vasopressin receptors in the cells lining the collecting duct of the nephron increases the protein expression of aquaporins. Aquaporins are channels that transport water out of the collecting duct, leading to more concentrated urine, but more importantly for this tutorial, the retention of water and the increase of blood pressure. Now that we understand the RAAS, it's much more straightforward to understand how ACE inhibitors lead to a decrease in blood pressure. ACE inhibitors bind to and block the active site of the enzyme. This stops angiotensin 1 from binding to the enzyme and therefore disrupts its function. When ACE is inhibited, less angiotensin 1 can be enzymatically converted to angiotensin 2. And since only angiotensin 2 is able to activate the angiotensin 2 receptor, there will be less contractility of vascular smooth muscle, less angiotensin-induced antidiuretic hormone release from the pituitary gland, and less aldosterone secretion from the adrenal cortex. Due to this multifaceted pharmacological mechanism, ACE inhibitors are an important tool in decreasing blood pressure, and they are widely prescribed for this reason.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.